Good evening. We do have a quorum present, and I'd like to call the September 20th, 2016 meeting of the Board of Education to order. We have three very special guests with us this evening. We have Kennedy Massey, a second grade student, Sawyer Dwinnels, a first grade student, and Adair Perini, a fifth grade student, and they're all from our brand new school where we just had a ribbon cutting last week, Jonathan Hager Elementary School. So if you'd like to come up to the microphone, and you're going to help us with the Pledge of Allegiance in a moment of silence.
Hello, my name is.
Would you like your colleagues to come up with you? Perfect.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. So welcome. This is exciting. I'm not sure we've ever had three students at the same time, so this is a first. So I'd like you to help us by introducing your family members that are here with you. Would you like to start, Adele?
My mom is Adele. Right there. Yeah, she's my mom. Her name's Nicole Perini. Yeah.
Okay. And let's see, who's next? Sawyer?
That is my mom. And
can you talk into the mic so we could hear?
That is my mom, and she is the vice principal.
Wonderful. Hi, Mom. And Kennedy, would you like to introduce anyone?
That's my grandma. She works for the
county. Is the mic on, Clay?
Let
I'm
me
not
turn
sure
it down.
It is. Hold on just a second. A little bit of technical difficulty here.
We just have to get it down a little bit. Would you reintroduce your people?
Put on.
That's my mom right there.
Hi, Mom.
That's my little sister. That's my grandma. That's my pap. That's my big sister. And that's my dad.
Thank you.
Oh my goodness, you have the whole second row back there. Oh my gosh, would everyone raise their hand? Okay, excellent. So what do you think of the new school, and what do you think of your first few weeks in the school?
I really like the collaboration rooms we have, and we get to get our own iPads, and I like that we can choose from the other clubs. And I also like that my mom works there because she's a music teacher.
When you're a little bit older, you may not want mom working in the school, but you know, that I'm just saying. Would anyone else like to share?
I like to see like all my friends at school and play on the playground two times and see my teacher, Miss Moss, and my mom is the vice principal, so I could get to see her.
That's wonderful. Can you pull that mic? Oh, very good. Pull it down. Just there you go.
I like about Jonathan Hager is my teacher. She is nice because she tells us to do our best. And my music teacher, Miss Perini, she's a good singer. And also my cherry on top is my grandma. She works for pre-K.
Thank
wow.
you.
Excellent. Anything else you'd like to share with us this evening? No? Okay. Any other questions from my colleagues?
I'll just say that Ms. Perini is a good singer. I was in her class during the ribbon cutting. She made me sing. I can't remember what the song was, but it was very animated.
You were a great big
mover. Well, you're very kind, but you're not telling the truth.
Excellent. Thank you so much for coming and spending this time with us this evening. And as I told you earlier, you're welcome to tiptoe out, or you can stay for the meeting.
Tiptoe.
Thank you very
Thank
much.
You.
I had told them earlier they were going to be the highlight of the meeting.
Yeah. And they were.
Okay, with that, we're going to look for approval of the agenda.
Madam President, I move for the approval of the agenda as recommended by the Agenda Planning Committee.
Second.
Thank you. Any questions on the recommended agenda? All those in favor, please signify. 6-0, and student concurs. And the minutes?
Yes, I move for approval of the minutes of the closed session held on Tuesday, September 6, 2016.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion on the first set of minutes? All those in favor? Abstention? And student, two abstentions, correct. So that's 5 in favor and 2 abstentions. Thank you. Next set.
I move for approval of the minutes of the business meeting held on Tuesday, September 6th, 2016.
Second.
Any discussion on the business minutes? All those in favor, please signify. Abstention? Okay, and student concurs with the majority. Thank you. So that brings us to public comments. We have two individuals signed up. First is Ellen Knoll. If you'll come forward, please. Welcome.
Thank you. Hi there. Okay, just so you know, I have a head cold, so I apologize.
And Mrs. Knoll, you have 5 minutes.
Okay, won't take that long because I had a prepared statement so I could look very professional this time. And you guys had a meeting today, and I got feedback from that meeting, and I heard positive feedback. I heard that you are listening to us, you're taking our concerns into consideration, and most of the concerns that I was going to spell out, you guys are addressing. And I appreciate that. So I did want to come forward and say thank you. And hopefully we can keep working together to make this work for us. As I said last time, we're parents, we're volunteers, we're tired. Okay? We're tired. I'm exhausted. And I guarantee you, these other parents that volunteer their time in the schools for our children are tired too. So I reiterate, as I said last time, don't make it harder for us. Please do not make it harder for us. Not only those of us that are volunteering, but to inspire other people to come and help us. It is so hard to get volunteers because parents are so busy. I've actually spoken to parents that said, well, if they do that, I'm not doing anything. Oh, I can't do that. Don't scare them away, okay? We want them to come and join us. It's such, I volunteer because I love these kids. I volunteered for my kid. For my kids, and now I have hundreds of kids because I've been doing it for a decade. They're wonderful, and I want to be able to continue to do it, so please don't make it harder. The only suggestion that I wanted to throw out there is that in the future, when something this big, something this important is going to be considered for change, I would prefer if maybe you would reach out to the parents, the people that are actually involved. You know, I'd have been happy to sit on that board with you guys and say, hey, wait a minute, I know from my experience this and this, because you probably just didn't know some of this stuff and how it would affect us. But again, I live in the real world, and in the real world you have to consider the real world consequences of decisions. So just in the future, if maybe you kind of include us, and then we can give you feedback, and then you don't have to go through all this, is just my suggestion. And I thank you for listening to me.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next signed up is Carlos Malott. You'll come forward, please. Welcome.
How are you doing? Yeah, good to see you. So I just wanted to, I noticed that on the agenda you all are going to be voting on whether or not to continue funding for the diversity training. And I just wanted to, maybe make a comment and also ask a question. So in terms of the comment, I just wanted to share with you some of the things that I've heard. And basically what I've heard is that there's room for improvement for the training. The facilitator was great. People really liked the facilitator, but that, you know, some of our staff felt, the people that I spoke with, felt that some of our own staff within WCPS could also provide that type of training because they just have the experience. And I had people questioning whether or not the board was getting the value for the amount of money that they were spending on the training. Now, I do have to say that I am a huge proponent and supporter of your diversity efforts. I'm very appreciative of that. I just wanted to kind of put that forward for you before you make your vote tonight. I don't really have an opinion either way because I never attended the training. And I think that actually would lead to my second question, which would be how many of you had the chance to attend the training either here at the board or in the schools, because I think they offered them in the schools as well. So just kind of wanted to put that question forward, but I appreciate everything you do and thank you for your consideration.
Yep. Thank you.
Thanks. Yep.
That's the last individual I have signed up. Is there anyone here who did not have an opportunity to sign up? Yes, ma'am. Welcome. Just fine.
I just had a question about the ad hoc committee. To this point, the information that's been available to me hasn't really made it clear what the impetus behind forming the ad hoc committee was for the diversity task force, and so I was hoping for further clarity on why it was formed, what the charge of it will be, and where that will leave parents such as myself who approached the board 3 years ago about this very issue.
And what we can do, we usually don't have back and forth conversations, but we do have a period in the agenda for response to public comment, and maybe the policy chair could give you a status update on the diversity discussion at that. Okay. Thank
could
you.
Could I get your name, please?
It's Dr. Tisdale.
Tisdale, thank mm-hmm. you.
Anyone else in the audience who would like to come forward? Okay. Thank you very much. Seeing none, that does bring us to board member response. Mrs. Fisher, not to put you on the spot, but I don't know if you might like to give just a brief update on
yes.
the status of the diversity discussion.
The Diversity Task Force originally was founded to recruit and retain a more diverse pool of teachers and administrators throughout the county. But as the, I guess it was 2 years passed, it seems as though the conversation got much broader to include many other related topics. And our HR department came to us and expressed the idea that we might want to change the composition and original stated goals of that group because there were other concerns out there and a lot of the other concerns were not really the topic that HR was familiar with and ready to work with. So it was recommended that, first of all, they sent to the policy committee the task of making some recommendations for this new group. And quite frankly, policy committee has been a little bit overloaded lately with work. And so we decided it would be a good idea perhaps to appoint an ad hoc committee to look at the minutes. We have a collection of the minutes and the items that the task force has considered and so on, and to look at the task force and come up with some recommendations as to perhaps some changes that can be made in the composition of the task force, as well as the actual charge or the purposes and goals for that. As I said, the policy committee has been very busy, especially with the fundraising policy, and we haven't been working on that Diversity Ad Hoc Committee. It's kind of been on hold for a little while, but we're hoping to wind up the fundraising in the not too far distant future, and then we will get back to the Diversity Ad Hoc Committee and their role in making some recommendations to the entire board for changes. So,
thank you, Ms. Fisher. Any additional board member comments?
I would like to make one additional comment to Mrs. Null. We did send out 30 or 40 letters to leaders of various fundraising groups. I was not responsible for coming up with the list. Some staff members were, so I don't know how the list was determined. But we did reach out to a number of those leaders. Not to every, obviously, club and organization that exists, but...
Thank you, Ms. Fisher. And what, just a recommendation, I know when you make a committee report later, maybe you can expand on that.
Yes,
under that agenda
I have a committee
item.
Report on the.
Okay,
what
any
happened
additional
today?
Any additional board member comments?
I just have one,
yes.
And that's as well to Mrs. Null, as well as all the people we've received feedback from on the fundraising policy. I certainly appreciate all of your feedback. I think it's helped us to make the policy better. As Mrs. Null said, she now has hundreds of kids and she loves kids. The seven of us up here have thousands of kids, and we're all here because we love kids too. And trust me when I tell you, we're not here trying to make your life more difficult. I know it may seem that way, but I think we want to work with all concerned parties because we all want the same thing. But I think we all want to work with concerned parties because we all care about these kids and want to find a way that's going to work for the people who are out raising money, work for the kids, and provide them the programming that we need. So thanks again for all of your feedback, and please understand that we want the same things you do. And I'll just leave it at that.
Seeing no other comments, we'll move forward. There is no unfinished business, so it takes us right to new business. And the first item for consideration is the contract agreement between the Washington County Board of Education and the Washington County Teachers Association. Mrs. Francisco? We have President Becker and Vice President Mary Newby. This is an action item, but usually we start with seeing if there's any comments from the two teams, and then I'll ask for a motion. And we'll take the vote at that time. So, President Becker, would you like to start?
Yes, I would. And then I'll hand off to Mary Newby, our negotiations chairperson. We're excited to have the opportunity to complete last year's negotiations and to move on. I hope that the board is as eager to ratify as the members were. I talked to Justin Hardings in passing this afternoon that we got a lot of feedback. That's the value of a paper ballot. We got a lot of feedback from members, both positive and negative regarding the agreement. The biggest being that, you know, we had spent months talking about time to more creatively come up with planning and professional development time. And they're hoping that that discussion can continue, especially in light of the new executive order that will require us to be more creative with our professional development time. We feel like we're kind of right on the edge there. We were close to coming up with something that was creative and innovative. But we appreciate the fact that with a little help from the outside, we were able to wrap things up very efficiently in August. So, Mary?
I just want to thank publicly the both teams that worked very hard starting in October to come up with this final paperwork for our upcoming agreement, and I know that we all look forward to negotiating the whole contract for the next 3 years, starting soon. So thank you again for both teams for the hard work that we all put into this.
Thank you very much. Ms. Francisco?
I don't have much to add other than I'm certainly pleased that we were able to reach an agreement, and we're looking forward to moving forward to the next year.
Dr. Wilcox, any comments?
No, I wasn't directly part.
Very good. All right. With that, again, this is an action item, so I'd be looking for a motion.
Madam President, I move to accept the contract agreement between the Washington County Board of Education and the Washington County Teachers Association for the 2016-2017 school year.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Thank you, Mrs. Fisher. Any discussion? Dr. Hardings?
Yeah, I'd like to just make a couple of brief comments. Thank you as well from me as a member of the board to both negotiation teams. I want to thank also the association for being willing to take a chance on having open negotiations. There's been some discussion in social media that and in correspondence that somehow the board insisted on that. And I think we don't do anything in the negotiations process that's not agreed upon. And we appreciate the association being willing to try that. I think each side learned some things. And I think from my perspective, one of the good things, at least that I saw come out of it, was it created a real conversation in this community about issues that were of concern to teachers, issues that were of concern to the administration, and how we can all best serve kids. And I think that was a great benefit, that the community could see that, because there was certainly, in this room, as those discussions were going on, great, great passion. And I think it's fair to say on both sides. And any time that we're having, as we are with the fundraising policy, any time we're having passionate discussions about how we can all best serve kids, I think that's a good thing for the system. And I don't know that the community would have had quite the window into that that they did have had we not had open negotiations. I'm not sure if it's a model for the future or not, but again, since we only could do that by mutual agreement, I want to thank you for being willing to take a chance and to try it.
Any other comments? I would like to just take a moment to use a word that was shared with me recently, and I think it speaks volumes. And we need to take a moment, I think, to celebrate teachers and the profession of teaching. And we all know that education is changing. There are a lot of challenges before us, and I know the profession of teaching is evolving along with education. So again, I think what we're here tonight is to celebrate not only this year's tough negotiations and a positive outcome, but to celebrate this school year going forward, and hopefully we can continue to work together and collaborate as an entire team here at WCPS. So again, thank you for the effort going forward. Any other comments before I call the vote? All those in favor, please signify. Abstention? Thank you. Student concurs with the majority. Thank you very much. And
Student abstains.
Thank you. I'll step down and we'll sign the paperwork.
Stuff together, so.
Thank you very much, Mary. Congratulations. Thank you. Neil, thank you very much. Thank you. Thanks for the association. Thank you. We keep board gets one.
Next item, consideration of Soul Source, creating a culture for inclusion.
Good evening. Tonight I have one item for your review, the details of which were included in your packet. Staff is seeking approval for the purchase of diversity training titled Creating a Culture of Inclusion from Max Life LLC at a not-to-exceed cost of $58,807. And staff is here if you have any questions.
Thank you. A motion, please.
Madam President, move to approve the purchase of Creating a Culture for Inclusion Diversity Training from Max Life LLC, not to exceed $58,807.
Thank you. And a second?
Second.
The floor is open for discussion on this item. Mrs. Fisher.
I have a question based on citizens' participation tonight. The training that was given and is proposed to continue, is there any way you can give me a explain how, say, the cost for this compares to other trainings we've offered that involve about the same amount of time and the same amount of presenters or anything?
I don't personally have that frame of reference. This is the first program of this size that we've done since I've been here. The trainers are reaching this year close to, what if we have, 900 people, 4 hours each. So it is a pretty intense program, an interactive program. But I can't answer that question directly, I'm sorry.
Are there a lot of materials, handouts, and items involved?
No, the presenters have a presentation. There are one or two handouts at the sessions, but it's really a lot of conversation and interaction between participants. So they are not billing us for materials. The only additional cost in the contract is besides their time and their work, is mileage.
They're how far away?
Frederick.
It's not like we're flying people in.
No.
I don't know. It just seems a little expensive to me. But
what's the workshop rate if we were paying teachers?
$25 an hour. It's 100. Well, you have the information. It's 114 hours total of their time.
Are you? Any additional questions, Ms. Fisher?
No, thank you.
Right now.
Yeah, this is a one-year contract.
Correct.
Okay, and we're doing some training trainers also involved in this. In other words, are we going to be some of the people that are? Does this just involve the people that are taking the class or taking the training?
Do
you understand where I'm coming from? Asking Laura.
Not a train-the-trainer model.
Okay.
This is a consultant, a paid service.
Perfect. That's what I need. Thank you.
Yes, Mr. Kessler.
I just want to make sure this was the same group that was with us last year, because I think it was invaluable. The information that, as a board member, where we sat and had our training, if you're out in the public. You get a lot of that, but what we received on hand, I've never seen that in depth, and I thought that was a really, really good training for us as board members, and I will be supporting that, because I think even if it's some of the same things, it's always good to go back and just drill that in you know, and the more that you hear it, the more you're going to recognize it. And so the ladies that were here that did the teaching in the class, wonderful people. And so thank you for, you know, bringing that program.
Sure. I'll add as well, since it was asked before, I attended the training, all 4 hours divided up over two sessions. So yes, I certainly was a part of it. And, you know, I found it to be very insightful, very valuable, and I certainly wouldn't vote to continue it if I didn't think that it were such. As for moving to a different model of finding somebody internal, first of all, there's a cost to that too, because you're then taking somebody away from the job they would normally be doing and asking them to do something else. But somewhat like you can't just throw somebody in front of a group of kids and say that they're a teacher, because teachers are professionals. I think the people who do this kind of work are professionals as well. And I think you pay a little for that expertise, as you should. And I think my experience of going through the training is that the individual who conducted it clearly is a professional, clearly has the experience, the insight, and the experience with clearly a number of different groups, so that she has a lot of experience to pull from as the conversation goes in a number of different directions. So I think that professionalism is clearly worth the investment to me. So I will support this procurement.
Additional comments? I would just add that the entire board was given the opportunity to participate in the training. I think, to your point, Dr. Hardings, didn't she have background with training military?
She did.
I think I recall that as well. And our student rep, Ms. Greenwald, attended the training as well. So I think it's something that was very helpful to the board. So we appreciated that opportunity. Okay. Seeing no further comments, I'll call the question. It's Mr. Ridenour's motion. All those in favor? 6-0, and student concurs with majority. I got it right that time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Let's see. Takes us to fourth quarter, the year-end budget adjustments. Mr. South, welcome.
Thank you. I am here for your approval of the requested fourth quarter budget adjustments for fiscal year 2016 for the Washington County Public Schools. As you're aware, Maryland law requires that no category may be overspent or underspent after the final budget adjustments. So these requested adjustments will bring our budget into line with our full year revenues and expenditures. As usual, I'm not going to go through these items line by line. But there are a couple of high-dollar items I would like to bring to your attention. First, on line 2, administration, excuse me, there we are requesting a reduction in our budget of $173,983 related to, say, about $77,000 in savings in printing supplies, and the remainder being a savings of in consultants in the testing area. Moving down to line 4, instructional salaries, there we're increasing the budget by nearly $130,000. And the reason for that is that the salary savings are slightly less than what we had estimated in the third quarter. We actually adjusted the salaries in the third quarter and sort of over-adjusted them by about $130,000. So we're just correcting that. Down in special education on line 7, we're requesting an increase of $230,000, where private placements were slightly higher than budgeted. Student transportation services on line 10, we had $214,000 savings in salaries and supplies. Moving down to operation of plant on line 11, we're requesting a reduction in the budget there of $839,000 due to savings in propane of approximately $324,000 and heating oil of approximately $229,000, and finally in technology hardware, savings of about $348,000. going up to the propane and the heating oil, if you'll remember, we did have a rather mild winter last year until we got that 1 week of a blast at the end of February. So what you're seeing there is savings from the relatively mild winter that we had last year. Down in maintenance of plant, you see we're adding $915,000 to that that category. And what we're doing there is we are redirecting savings from other categories to needed summer projects. And some of those projects, examples of some of those projects are we added some classroom partitions at Springfield Middle School. Pleasant Valley and Boonesboro Elementary received security vestibules. There was some repair work done on the barn for the agricultural program at Clear Spring High School. Pangborn was, we added a restroom in the gym area at Pangborn. E. Russell Hicks, we did some air conditioning work. And finally, we did some macadam walks at Smithsburg High School, Clear Spring High School, and some macadam playground and parking at Daub. Moving down to line 15, fixed charges. You see there that we're reducing the budget by almost $500,000. That is a result of savings in retirement of nearly $438,000. That was the result of a rate decrease in the employee system, a $10,000 savings in life insurance, and retirement sick leave savings of $49,000. All of that brings us down to a net increase in our fund balance of $793,671. And if we add that amount to our fund balance after the payoff of the Barbara Ingram School debt, our general fund balance will stand at $8.25 million. Now, $580,000 of that is committed to the public-private partnerships, $4 million is committed to the downtown educational complex, and the remaining $3.66 million is currently unassigned. Having said all that, I would request your approval of the fourth quarter budget adjustments, and of course, I'd be glad to try to entertain any questions that you may have.
Thank you, Mr. South. A motion, please.
Madam President, I move to approve the proposed FY 2016 fourth quarter budget adjustments.
Thank you, Ms. Williams. Second?
Second.
Mr. Gessford? Any questions for Mr. South? Ms. Fisher?
I don't know. Maybe I'm missing something, but what's retirement sick leave?
Retirement sick leave is a line that we budget for when folks retire, they can sell back their sick days.
Oh, okay. I didn't know that.
Additional questions?
I just want to make a comment, if that's okay. I appreciate your going through the list of projects that were able to be accomplished through the increase to maintenance of plant. As I've said a few times, years ago we put every available extra dollar into maintenance of plant, and have really continued to do that over the last eight years. Not only does it reduce the maintenance backlog, I think it helps save the county money. And it really does improve the appearance of many of our schools. Some of the projects aren't big. They're as small as, you know, things in parking lots and sidewalks and ramps. But that really changes the appearance of a school, makes it feel more welcoming, makes our employees, I hope, feel better when they walk into the building every day. So I just wanted to emphasize that, because I know as we continue to go back and forth discussing with the commissioners about matches for state funds for doing capital projects. Certainly this year we've put a good bit of every bit of savings we've been able to find into trying to do our part.
Thank you. Good comment. Any additional questions or comments? Okay, seeing none, all those in favor? 6-0, student concurs. Thank you. And you're staying right there, I think, for the next item.
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Consideration inclusion of all 403B vendors as 457B vendors. Ms. Keller, welcome.
Hello.
Some 18 months ago, the board awarded contracts to four supplemental retirement vendors to provide 403B products to WCPS employees. One of those vendors, MetLife, was well known to the board, and MetLife has provided 457B services to WCPS employees with excellent results for nearly a decade. As a result of this knowledge, the board awarded contracts for both 403B service and 457B services to MetLife. The other three vendors that the board approved in 2015 were Voya, AXA, and Plan Member Services. These three were offered contracts to provide 403B products, with the caveat that after at least 1 year of satisfactory performance and at the board's discretion, any or all of the three could be offered a contract to provide 457 products as well. I'm pleased to report that Voya, AXA, and Plan Member Services have now successfully been serving many of WCPS's employees' 403B needs for nearly a year and a half. The employees who use them are very satisfied and have asked that they be included as vendors in the 457 plan. As they are very satisfied with their representatives, they would like the same representative to handle both their 403B and their 457 needs. On August 30th, the Benefits Department recommended to the Finance Committee that Voya, AXA, and Plan Member Services be added as 457B vendors. The Finance Committee agreed to move this request forward for approval by the full board. At this time, we would request your approval of these three vendors as 457B vendors as well.
Very good. Thank you. A motion on this item.
Madam President, I move that the board exercise its option to add Voya, AXA, and Plan Member Services as vendors for the Board of Education's 457B Supplemental Retirement Plan.
Thank you, Ms. Williams. A second?
Second.
Dr. Hardings. Any questions for staff? Seeing none, all those in favor, please signify. 6-0, student concurs. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Our final item under new business this evening is to approve proposed candidates for membership on the Calendar Advisory Committee. Dr. Michael.
Good evening, Mrs. Spraven, members of the board. Dr. Wilcox, I'm here on behalf of your committee for the calendar, requesting your approval of the committee members as described during closed session.
Is there a motion?
Madam President, I move to approve the appointment of members to the Calendar Advisory Committee as recommended by staff.
A second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Ridenour. Just by way of explanation, as courtesy to our candidates, we handle this section very much like we do personnel. And once the vote is taken, then the list is made public at that time. All those in favor?
Can I come?
I'm sorry. Okay. Abstention? Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
And I'm sorry, I cut some board members short. Dr. Hardings wanted to make a comment. Sorry.
I can save it for board member comments. No, sure. No problem.
Okay, thank you. Sorry about that. That's the end of our new business section, and we're on to the superintendent's update. Dr. Wilcox.
Thank you. The first thing that I want to share is earlier today we had the great privilege of serving our transportation team breakfast, and I want to thank local restaurateur Randy Scott at Chick-fil-A for generously donating Chick-fil-A sandwiches, breakfast sandwiches, and orange juices for all of our transportation department team members, not just the drivers, but the bus attendants who ride with them, and also then into the back office where they helped with the mechanics and other folks who provide. It was really a fun morning to see the joy on people's face. I truthfully was surprised at how many people wanted to hug the cow. It shocked me, really, to see how many people just walked up and hugged the cow before they even got a breakfast sandwich. They just wanted to hug that cow. But I just want to thank Randy and his team. He brought over three people, one who donned the costume, and two young women who just had such an of-service attitude. They were running through the parking lot, handing Chick-fil-A sandwiches and orange juices to people. If somebody said, "I don't want orange juice," they would sprint back across the lot, grab a water, and take them the water. So it was just a terrific morning. I also want to thank some of my team members that were there. Dr. Pugh came over this morning. Dr. Michael was there, and Jamie Hayde were there really early. Of course, Barb Scotto and the transportation team were there. But it was just a really neat morning to award a breakfast to some of the hardest working people in the district. So board members, next year, if we are able to do it again, we're going to let some of you come along and see it, because first of all, watching transportation in the morning is really an awesome experience, to see the orchestration that they have in place of getting all the buses in and out so quickly. But secondly, just to see the joy on the faces of people who serve our kids well. And in many cases, the first voice and the first face that students have in contact with Washington County Public School every single day. So in many ways, our transportation team sets the tone for how our school day goes each and every day. And I want our drivers and our bus attendants to know how much I appreciate that. The second thing I wanted to mention is we had great news this week for all of our athletes and parents of athletes, that our young people have once again will have the opportunity next year to rejoin an athletic conference that includes the Frederick County schools, particularly the larger high schools. Clear Spring and Hancock will have the opportunities to play schools of similar size, but when you take a look at North, South, Boonesboro, Smithsburg, and Williamsport, they'll have the opportunity to compete against like-sized schools Frederick as well as here against each other. The last thing that I want to share today is that many people who watch our board meetings know that we've had an ongoing discussion with Children's Village, and all of us absolutely value Children's Village as an entity in the community. I think all of us can point to stories of great success, and in fact, many of the people closely aligned with Children's Village can point to situations where young people's lives have been saved or been altered dramatically by the experiences they got at Children's Village, and so we certainly want that project to keep moving forward. But one of the things that we've come across is a bit of growing pains between the acquisition, if you will, or the merger. And there just seem to be a number of folks at Children's Village who are going to take more time and help us to better define how that partnership will look like. So for those people who were perhaps sitting at home saying, well, you know, when is the school system going to take full responsibility? That's just not going to happen right now. We're going to continue to be good partners. Our kids are going to continue to go. We're going to continue to support the organization. As I mentioned to some of the board members earlier, many of us had the great pleasure of going over to their fundraiser last week where they had breakfast in the community, and it was a free will donation, and I know many of our team members were there, but I just want to make sure that signals within the community don't get crossed. We still absolutely value and support the mission of Children's Village. We're going to stand by the leadership team at Children's Village, and we're going to try to make sure that it's here for many generations to come. But just because we have this little bump in the road doesn't mean that there's ill abound. The last thing I have is really a simple one, and that's really just an announcement. We're really excited about the progress that Bester is making in terms of embracing the larger community. One of the great things about the Community of Hope and the partnership that we have going on there right now is just the access that our young people are having to people who care deeply about them, people who can demonstrate that they are role models. And we have, I believe, coming up on October 13th, an activity where the Community of Hope is going to be awarded a very large grant from AT&T. We think we're going to have some celebrity guests there. I'm going to leave that for the paper and others to publish, but I hope, board members, you'll mark down on your calendars October 13th to be at Bester and help celebrate this Community of Hope and the partnership with AT&T. With that, I'm going to turn it back to you, Madam President.
Thank you, Dr. Wilcox. Personnel. Welcome, Ms. Francisco.
Mrs. Brightman, Dr. Wilcox, members of the board, as discussed earlier in closed session, there are several personnel actions for your review and approval this evening.
An action, a motion, please.
Madam President, move to approve the personnel action presented to us by the HR department earlier today.
Thank you, Mr. Ridenour. Second?
Second.
Fisher. All those in favor, personnel action. Abstention?
Thank you.
Thank you. Brings us to reports to the board. Year-end update. Mr. South, you're popular this evening. And Mrs. Keller returns. Thank you.
Good evening. We are here this evening to give you an update on the status of the Washington County Public Schools health care self-insurance program as of the end of June, which is
Yourself,
the end of our fiscal year.
Can you pull the mic over just a little
Sorry.
Bit? Sorry. Thank you.
Okay. I'm sorry, I'm not seeing it here. Okay, good. There we go. As a way of background information for folks that may be viewing or maybe here in the audience that are unfamiliar with our healthcare program, we are self-insured for medical, surgical, prescription drugs, and dental benefits. WCPS is also fully insured for vision benefit, and we carry specific stop-loss insurance at a $300,000 level to protect the plan against outlier claims. We do manage the healthcare fund as required by the AICPA in an internal service fund. Our plan administrators for FY16 for medical surgical, Cigna was effective last July 1st. Cigna also administers our prescription drug plan. United Concordia administers our dental plan, and our vision plan is fully insured through National Vision Administrators, or NVA. NVA and United Concordia plans are will be out for bid this coming spring. In looking at what the Board of Education pays, the Board of Education does pay the lion's share of the premium costs for its employees. For those employees who select the premium option, the board pays 81.3% of that premium. For the employees who select the standard option, the board pays 85%. And for those that select the limited option, the board pays 86.3% of the premium cost. Looking at the enrollment in fiscal year 16, 62.5% of the folks that were enrolled in the plan were employees. About 6% of the enrollees were made up of retirees who were under 65 years of age, and another 31.5% were made up of retirees who are on our Medicare supplemental plan. Had a total number of participants or enrollees of 3,618 at year end. The value of this benefit is very substantial to employees and retirees. The value of the health insurance benefit to the average employee at Washington County Public Schools in fiscal year 2016 was $13,400.
Mr. South.
Yes.
Could I ask a quick question before I forget it up here?
Certainly.
Would you, what is the range for an individual or a family? I mean, the average obviously 13.4 or 13,400.
The range runs from about 7,500 to about 22,000
for family. 22,000?
For okay. family on the premium plan, yes. Right.
So we are paying anywhere from 7,500 to 22, over a little over 22,000.
Yes, sir, that's correct. The board paid the board's cost to provide the benefit in fiscal 16 was approximately $31 million, And I would point out that for our employees, this is a tax-free benefit. So this is a real benefit for our employees. One of the best plans around, if not the best medical plan around. Let's take a look at the historical plans. I think we missed one. Did I miss one? There we go. Let's take a look at the historical plan cost. And here you'll see in the center column, you see the plan cost for the year. This is total plan cost now, not just the board share, but total plan cost. And on the right-hand side, in the right-hand column, you'll see the percent of increase over the prior year. And what I'd like to point out in this slide is that it appears that we're looking at something that is of a cyclical pattern here. You'll see that back in 2008 and 2009, the cost increased by over 15%. And in 2010, the increase started to decline slightly. We went down to about 9%, and then flattened out in the 3-5% range for about 4 or 5 years. In 2015, we saw an increase up to 8.6%, and now in 2016, we saw an increase of 12.1% in the cost over the prior year. So what I believe we're seeing here is a cyclical cost, and that's certainly what we hope. We hope we're not seeing the beginning of a trend, but we are monitoring that to make sure that what we are seeing is cyclical and not the beginning of a trend as we move from 14 into 15 and into 16. If we look at the historical plan strength as defined by the fund balance, in the second column from the left there, you see the fund balance reserve. For the years 2007 through 2016. The next column shows what our fund balance goal is. Our fund balance as you recall, is 10 times our highest possible exposure, and with our highest possible exposure being our specific stop loss of $300,000, our plan fund balance goal does stand at $3 million. You'll see there that the fund balance reserve seems to be rising and falling right along with those increases and decreases in the plan that we saw in the prior slide. In those early years, you'll see that the fund balance is decreasing from $7 million all the way down to $490,000 as we saw some high increases in plan cost on that last slide that we looked at. Then we see it kind of flatten out and actually increase a little bit as we move into 2014. We came into a high of almost $9.5 million in fund balance, and then as costs began to increase again, our fund balance is actually reduced now down to about $750,000. As I mentioned, The plan remains solvent. The year-end balance was approximately $750,000, and that fund balance of $750,000 is $6.1 million less than what it was at the end of fiscal year 2015. So what caused that reduction in the fund balance? Well, there's two contributing factors. First of all, part of that reduction was a result of us consciously implementing premium increases that were less than what was actuarially recommended, because as you recall, we did have about a $9.5 million fund balance, trying to get that fund balance down into the $3 million range to hit our $3 million target. Unfortunately, we got hit by several other factors, and you'll see that according to this slide, in fiscal year 2016, we were hit with several factors that exacerbated the decrease in our fund balance. When we compare our group's performance to Cigna's book of governmental business, that would be plans with groups very similar to ours, not looking at the large mega corporations, but looking at other governmental units. Our claimants with cumulative full year cost of over $25,000 were almost twice what Cigna was seeing in comparable groups. Our emergency room visits per 1,000 participants was significantly up over what they saw in their regular their standard book of business. Expensive specialty drug usage. This is things like the Hep C drugs that can be very, very expensive, are significantly higher in our group. And then admissions per 1,000 covered lives is significantly higher in our group. Interestingly, the number two number two diagnosis for our group is cancer-related claims. And those cancer-related claims push up the and contribute to the four items that I have just mentioned. The cumulative costs of $25,000 or more per year, emergency room visits, expensive specialty drug therapy because some of the cancer drugs are very, very expensive, and then admissions per 1,000. So what we've done to try to maintain the plan strength, we've implemented an 8% premium increase for fiscal year 2017. Your staff is monitoring plan costs on a monthly basis, as I mentioned before, to determine whether we're looking at a cyclical pattern or whether we are looking at the beginning of a trend toward higher utilization. And then Bolton Partners is providing analysis and assisting us with some early proactive determination of any required rate adjustments for fiscal year 2018. And unfortunately, I would have to report to you that if the trend does not reverse itself significantly over the year, we will be looking at another large increase next year. All that being said, I'll be glad to answer any questions that you may have.
Thank you. We've heard the report. Any questions for staff? Mr. Kessler.
I have just one question. I would just question the 8%. Is that going to be enough?
We are certainly hoping that it will be, and we will be able to cash flow the any losses that we may incur, but any losses that the plan takes over the year will have to be made up in the form of rate increases for FY18. So we're not concerned about any inability to cash flow any claims for this year, but we are concerned about if that fund balance goes into a negative situation, how that will impact the rate increase next year. It will obviously exacerbate any rate increase next year.
Chris, it might help if you explain to Mr. Gessler how you came to an 8% increase. It wasn't just a number that you picked out. You worked with the consultants, the actuarials who looked at
The actuarial consultants did recommend an 8% increase this year early on. They revised that slightly upward later in the year, but we opted to stay with the 8%. Because our budget was, by the time that it was revised upward, our budget was finalized.
But they did recommend upping it a little bit more.
They did, and
how much more?
I think it was a percent or two.
Additional question, Mr. Gessler? Any other questions, Dr. Hardings?
Thank you. It is a difficult thing because you don't want to increase it any more than you have to, not only because it affects our budget, but more importantly, it affects our employees and those who choose to take advantage of this benefit. It certainly affects what their take-home net pay amount is.
Absolutely.
Although it doesn't affect their gross pay. So you don't want to do too much because you don't want to put that stress on those families or on the board's budget, but you do want to do enough to make sure that the system is solvent for the long term. And I appreciate seeing the comparison with Cigna's other government clients. As I've looked and followed, because I buy my insurance on the private healthcare market because I'm self-employed, as I've looked at what rate increases are out in the private sector, 8% is still pretty low. It may not seem low, but this year, under the Affordable Care Act, 15 to 20% is not uncommon across many, many states, including Maryland. It is always difficult to figure out where you're going to make that determination about this is going to be enough or not enough, because this exists in a broader market, and certainly our employees exist in the market that they live, not just healthcare, but everything else that they have to pay for. So I appreciate the thoughtfulness that you bring this to us with, and I'm hopeful that 8% is enough. If it's not, some hard decisions will have to be made.
In response to your comment, Dr. Hardings, it is a very dynamic number, the actuarial percentage, which moves from month to month. So what is 10% last month might be 8% this month, might be 7% the following month, might be 15% the month after that. So it's a very dynamic number. And in response to your comment about the increases nationwide, Kiplinger just reported in their letter yesterday, I believe it was, that the average 5-year increase for health insurance rates across the board has been 19%. Ours over the last 5 years has been 12. So we have tried to keep it, as you said, keeping people's pocketbooks in mind, but yet keeping the plan solvent.
It's difficult because you're always chasing the past, right?
I mean,
absolutely. The actuaries can only work with what has happened. And
absolutely. And as I mentioned, by the time we got revised actuarial numbers, our budget had already been finalized, been presented to the commissioners and approved. So it was a little late to make any changes at that time. Plus, our employees had already started making plans, their plans for their increase for the coming year at 8%.
Additional questions, comments? I had one. I know you work with Cigna on comparison, but have you talked to your colleagues across the state, other CFOs with their self-insured plans at school districts, where we compare and contrast with other school districts? Do you have a sense of that?
Our increases have been significantly lower over the last 5 years compared to other school districts in the state of Maryland. Again, when you're self-insured, you're paying claims. So it's all dependent upon the claims that you're paying. And as I said, hopefully what we're seeing is a cyclical pattern that will once again drop down and flatten out for us. That's what we're hoping for.
I just know that Cigna, one of their signature parts when we went with them was their wellness offering. And I didn't know if we had any sense of whether that had helped keep premiums lower or claims fewer, or do you have any sense of that?
I'm going to let Gina field that one because she heads up our wellness program.
I do know when we were looking at the number of hospital admissions, one of the things that we looked at was compared to our last year's data with Care First, that our number of hospital admissions had gone up, but the dollar amount that was paid out per admission was actually a little lower this year than it was in our previous year. So we're hoping that's because they're managing our dollars a little better. We were very fortunate to receive a large sum of money from Cigna to start our wellness program. And last year we did some things like mini grants that we just put that money right back into the schools so that the schools could decide themselves how they wanted to use those funds. We also did biometric screenings just to try to get people to come in and learn their blood pressure and learn their maybe BMI and things like that if they hadn't already done that themselves through a well physical. So we've already talked about how we want to use our funds for this year and promote a health
you know, health fair. We're doing health risk assessments. So we are trying to do some things for everybody throughout the district, as well as letting the schools decide what they think would be best suited for their staff. We've also looked at, we're just different things. We've had just one wellness committee so far this year, so we're anxious to get started and go from there. So,
just a couple of things. One is, the other thing that you have to consider is kind of the changing demographics of the school system. We have a lot of young folks who are coming in who don't think that insurance is necessarily important to them because they're invincible, so they aren't participating perhaps at the level that we might expect or want. We have a lot of folks who are on the retirement side, and some of the treatments that they get are more expensive treatments and perhaps more frequent. If you take a look a little further back in Chris's presentation at the six-year look back, one of the things that you'll note as you look at the years 2011 through 2016 is the relative percentage between the employer contributions and the retiree contributions remains the same, although they're both increasing over time. But the thing that kind of jumps out at me is what that actually then buys. And that's that point I was trying to make earlier, that we have younger people who perhaps aren't taking advantage of the plan, veteran teachers who are taking advantage of the plan and its benefits. The other thing I would point out to you is, if you take a look down in the next section, look at what's happened to prescription drugs. In 2015, our prescription drug costs had gone up to over $12 million, up from a low of about $9 million. Now, we did have a little scale back in 2016, but you know, that's really a $3 million increase in prescription drugs alone. And that's a challenge for us. So we'll continue to monitor it. We have some very good partners who are helping us assess. If we absolutely need to make an increase in the contribution rates, we will come to the board, obviously, and talk to the board about our rationale for that, because we have to keep the plan solvent. There's, you know, too many people count on us for the benefit. But I think it is something that we have to continue to talk about with our bargaining partners and with you as a board, as to the richness of our benefits and, you know, the affordability of those same benefits.
Thank you. Any additional comments before we close the report out? Thank you very much. Appreciate the update. So that takes us to board member committee reports. Ms. Greenwald, would you like to begin?
Sure. The county SGA met last Tuesday, and we would like to thank the advisor, Mrs. Hamilton, and her students for hosting us. We had a really successful meeting. Dr. Pugh came and was our keynote speaker and continued our discussion on the student eye team and that idea and how we can make that come to fruition. We had our state director for SGA come and do some leadership development. Other things we're doing right now is we have an advisor workshop tomorrow for all the, every single high school advisor will be attending and just getting an update for the year with what our plans are and just how to keep a sustainable organization. And we are also planning our upcoming leadership retreat.
Thank you. Mrs. Francisco, Mrs. Harshman isn't here, Chair of HR. Was there a date for the next meeting? Do you have that time?
9 o'clock.
Okay, so HR 9 o'clock on September 27th, correct? Thank you. Mrs. Williams.
Yes, the Finance Committee has not met since our last meeting, and there will not be a meeting this month. There will not be a September meeting.
Yes, the Facilities Committee will be having their monthly meeting on September the 27th at 7:45 upstairs in the third floor conference room, and we'd like to invite the public to come out and attend.
Thank you. Ms. Fisher.
Policy Committee met this morning. We had a rather lively discussion on the fundraising policy. A number of stakeholder concerns were addressed, and most of those were altered, I believe, to the satisfaction of the people who happened to attend our meeting this morning. We did make one major decision, which we believe will help each type of fundraising group better understand the new rules for their particular type of organization. And that decision is that we're going to break this policy down into three policies. One of the comments we heard was that this seven-page policy was plus exhibits was rather overwhelming. And this, of course, will shorten the policy. Also, the fact that we had three very distinct groups made it confusing for some people. Some people in the emails that we had been getting, it was clear that they were mixing ideas from all three groups into one. They weren't paying attention, evidently, to the separation of the different organizations. So what we're going to do, or what we're planning to do, is to have one policy for those organizations who are actually incorporated. That's primarily PTAs, but I believe there are some BAM booster groups who are incorporated as well. And many of the items that they are required to do, either by state law, federal law, or by, for instance, the PTA parent organizations at the state level and national level, some of those reports and so on they fill out for those organizations can just be turned in then to make up for the reports that you were going to have to do in addition to those reports. Another group would be the school-based organizations. Those are primarily organizations that are advised by teachers, things like French clubs, school newspaper, yearbook, things like that. And then finally, the last group will be the booster groups, which are primarily connected to athletics or the bands, the courses, maybe drama clubs, and so on. We do think this is going to help each group understand better what we're requesting of them. Hopefully it will eliminate some of the confusion that we've seen. And we were planning to have a meeting next Tuesday on the 27th, but because there's a major task at breaking this into three policies, we are holding off that meeting until October the 11th. And that will be at 9 a.m. Here in the board meeting room. And as usual, it is open to the public to attend.
Thank you, Ms. Fisher. Mr. Ridenour.
Thank you, Madam President. the Curriculum Instruction Committee will meet the 27th at 9:45 in the third floor conference room.
Thank you. Any additional reports, committee reports that I've missed? Ms. Williams, anything from MABE?
We have our last conference planning committee meeting before the annual conference. That committee meeting is on Friday of this week, September 23rd. I'd like to thank Dr. Wilcox for his contribution of books and WCPS branded materials that will be used as door prizes for the conference attendees. Dr. Wilcox is always very, very good to MABE in coming up with things that are treasured by those lucky winners.
We're fortunate to have people who buy good things.
Okay. Yes, Mr. Wright.
I apologize, Madam President. Mrs. Fisher just showed me our typical curriculum instruction time frame. It should be 10:45 on the 27th in the third floor conference room, not 9:45.
Very good. Thank you for that clarification. All right. We'll look at future agenda items briefly just to let my colleagues know that Comptroller Franchot will be in town on October 4th at 11 at Clear Spring Elementary, awarding the Silver Hammer Award at that time. We do usually have our day meeting then, so staff is looking at some way that we could possibly go up to Clear Spring, maybe have our closed session meeting there and allow us to possibly spend some time with Mr. Francho. So stay tuned. We'll let you know as that develops on October 4th. Other than that, we'll be looking at our financial statement audit also on October 4th. We'll be seeing our hearing student achievement updates on the 4th. And looking forward, we'll have some final enrollment numbers, student enrollment, and free and reduced meal rates the 1st of November. Are there any agenda items any board member would like us to consider to bring forward? Okay, seeing none, we'll finish the evening with board member comments. Ms. Greenwald, would you like to start out?
Sure. Recently, I was appointed to the student member of the Maryland Board of Education's Student Advisory Council. I will be attending our first meeting this Saturday in Rockville, where we will be discussing the impact of the governor's executive order and what student advocacy will look like for this year.
Excellent. We'll look forward to hearing a report back on the executive order. Interesting. Mrs. Williams.
Congratulations on your appointment, Erica. I'd like to thank my colleagues for a very productive day. We started off with what I thought was a very productive policy committee meeting at noon, and I think we had a very good work session where we discussed our legislative priorities, and a good closed session, and a productive business meeting. So thank you, colleagues.
Very good. Thank you. Dr. Wilcox.
Thank you. I just wanted to say to the board members, but also to the community, that you know we've now completed the final contract negotiations with our employee groups. And you know, while I think everybody sitting around this table would have loved to have given more, we had a budget and we had to stay within that budget. As those conversations were taking place, I shared with the board that I would not ask for any compensation increase while we were unsettled with some of our employee groups. I simply want to say to the board, I plan not to ask for anything. I want to thank you for your generosity in the past, but I think I'm well compensated for the job that I do in this community, and I think it sends the right message of responsibility to simply say, thank you very much for extending my contract earlier this year. I very much appreciate that, but I am not going to request any change in my compensation for this year. So I want to thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Wilcox. Dr. Hardings.
Yes, I just want to thank the members of the community who volunteered to serve on the calendar committee. We had great enthusiasm, unfortunately a lot more applications to serve than we could put on a committee that has its membership capped at a certain number. So to all those people who may not have been appointed, we appreciate your enthusiasm. We have lots of other committees you can serve on and lots of other work that needs to be done in the school system, so please continue to volunteer. We promise we'll take you up on making the best we can of your skills as you're willing to volunteer them to serve our students. And a last word on the calendar. You know, 2 years ago we had a robust discussion about the calendar. There was some disagreement in the community, disagreement among board members. This calendar is going to probably be difficult as well, given the new constraints that we need to operate under. Given the desire to perhaps think about calendar differently and think about professional days differently, snow days differently, think about spring break differently, think about all the days off, all those are going to come into play as we work through this. I would just, I guess, echo what I said earlier to the speaker, which is everybody involved in this discussion wants to do and is going to want to do what they think is best for kids. And I hope that as our passions get ratcheted up, and we all have them because we're passionate about kids, I hope we can all keep that in mind. Because when we focus on doing what's right by kids, I think we do our best work. When we question the motives of the other people who may think differently about what's best for kids, that's when I think we start to get into trouble. So I would like to invite the community, as we have this conversation, to all bear that in mind. I think that'll take us to the best calendar we can come up with that'll best serve the students in this community. Thank you.
Thank you. Well said. Mr. Gasford.
Yes, I just want to thank Kathy Stiles and her staff out at the Jonathan Hager Elementary for a wonderful ribbon-cutting ceremony. They did a fantastic job. The students, the parents that attended, my colleagues, it was just a real enjoyable time to be out there celebrating the opening of the newest school here in Washington County. And also just a speedy recovery to our colleague, Karen Harshman, who is out after her surgery. Hope that she gets back soon.
Very good. Mrs. Fisher.
I'll just echo what Mr. Gasford said about Jonathan Hager. Thanks again to the faculty administration for a wonderful program.
Mr. Breidenauer.
Just a couple of things real quickly. Number one, I'd like to, if you remember correctly, earlier I had asked Dr. Wilcox and staff to look at the extended recess time. And from what I'm hearing, it's been met with a great deal of enthusiasm, not only by students, but I believe also by staff, because the kids come back to them a little more refreshed and ready to go. Secondly, I've told some of my colleagues the story this past weekend. I found out that one of my former students, Ms. Hannah Gerson, if you remember the name, Dr. Gerson's daughter, had just published, or has her first book has just been published. So I had the opportunity to go down to Boonesboro, where she was part of a book signing with Nora Roberts and four other authors. And it was so wonderful to see the young lady, and knowing that what I thought would happen with her has come to pass, because she could write. Easily the best writer I had in 30 years of teaching. And for my board colleagues, I wanted to tell you that I spoke on your behalf, and I hope you forgive me for that, but I spoke with Nora Roberts for a few minutes and thanked her for everything that she has done in the Boonesboro community and for the students of Washington County. So I'm not above groveling on occasion and sucking up, as they say. So it was a great day. It was a great day seeing Hannah. It was a great day meeting Mrs. Roberts, and you like those kind of days.
Thank you, Mr. Reidenauer. I'll just add to that. I know the entire Boonesboro community is looking forward to that public-private partnership with the Nora Roberts Foundation and trying to bring the auditorium up to where it should be. There's a wonderful performing arts community there in Boonesboro, and I know they're looking forward to that, so I hope we're able to get the paperwork going and get that moving forward. Other than that, if I see no other comments, we are at the end of the agenda, and we are adjourned. Thank you.
Let's go home.